Hi, everybody. My name is Tamara Monroe, and my project was on sleeping together or sleeping apart from your partner, and finding a balance between the two. So sleeping separately from your partner is not the cultural norm, it is not widely accepted, but it's also not something that we talk about too frequently. I have some examples of pop culture of movie stars sleeping separate from their partners and sometimes living completely in different houses. So in the 1920s, Fanny Hurst was a movie star who created waves by, she lived in a completely separate apartment in the same apartment building from her husband. And when somebody leaked it, it became a huge deal. In late 2016, rumors started about Julia Roberts living separately from her husband, not because they were getting a divorce, but because they were trying to save their marriage. And a more famous example of who since have separated is Tim Burton and Helena Bonham Carter. They were together for 13 years, but they ran separate households. I guess they were like townhomes and they had a shared courtyard, which I think is pretty cool. So for many Americans, sleep is a huge deal. Am I getting enough sleep? Why do I wake up in the middle of the night? Why is my Fitbit telling me I'm only sleeping 3 hours a night? Which is true, that's what it tells me. I can remember struggling with sleep from like seventh grade. I remember I would go to bed at 7 p.m. because it would take me 2 hours to fall asleep. And like I can never take a power nap because how do you take a power nap when it takes you 2 hours to fall asleep? So that's where I'm coming from and my experience with that. But poor sleep leads to an increase in depression, an increase in stress hormones, the use of depressant substances like NyQuil, Benadryl, alcohol. And it also increases risky behavior. For example, if you are sleeping with a partner and you are tired and not thinking correctly, you might not use a condom when you normally would have if you were in a different state of mind. And also for undergraduate students, it leads to lower grades and lower GPAs. So since sleep has always been a struggle for me, I've been trying to understand why potentially. My parents told me when I was a baby, I was super independent and I would put myself to sleep at 9 p.m. every night. They didn't have, like my cousins had these struggles like running around, I don't wanna go to bed, I don't wanna take a nap. Like I never had that problem. I loved sleep and I'd put myself to bed. So like they put me in my own room from like super, super early. I don't even know if they ever had a bassinet or anything. And so I was in my own room in my own bed from like pretty much birth until I was 20. And going from being alone in my own bed to sleeping with a partner was a super big struggle, as we're about to see. While doing research for this project, I found out that sleeping 8 hours in a row is a myth. Primates naturally wake up after 3 or 4 hours, check for predators, go to the restroom, and then go back to sleep to wake up at dawn. So humans are the same way. In fact, Benjamin Franklin actually came up with some of his best inventions during these wee hours. However, if you don't have the money like Ben Franklin did to burn candles all night, what are you gonna do? You're gonna spend the time boning the person next to you. Right? But this doesn't work for me, and we're gonna get into that in a little bit. So for a little backstory, my husband and I got married when we were like 22. So we were pretty young. He was in the military. We actually spent our first year of marriage apart. When he got back from deployment, We, you know, tried to sleep in the same bed, and it became a struggle for us. The only job that I could get was as a bartender, and so I would be coming home at 1 a.m. every night, and he would have to get up at 5 a.m. and get to work by 5:30 for physical therapy Monday to Friday. So me coming in at 1 a.m. and then him leaving only a couple hours later was disrupting sleep for him, but also for me. And that was when I started sleeping on the couch, and I would go into the bed after he would leave. So when we, when he got out of the military and we moved back to Colorado, we set up our house with two separate beds, two separate bedrooms, and that was normal for us. So I'm still a bartender, we're both college students, and we both have jobs on top of that. So our schedules are so different, and it is just easier to stay sleeping separately. So during this class, I learned that we were missing some parts of this love triangle. It's a triangular theory of love. We actually were missing some of this intimacy, non-sexual intimacy. There was always commitment because from the very beginning we were communicating and talking, and we always had passion. We never had a problem talking about our sexual needs, wants, desires, that sort of thing. But the intimacy non-sexually was kind of a problem. So for the experiment, I wasn't exactly sure what I wanted to do for it. I wasn't sure where it was going to end up or how I should get there. So we started out by sitting down and talking with each other. We discussed our goals for our relationship, where we wanted to be, where we saw ourselves in the future, and we opened some lines of communication which had been shut down. Second, we committed to each other that we were going to pay more direct attention to each other rather than sitting there at dinner on our phone or watching TV. So we both made that decision to pay attention to each other. And then I explained that I wanted more cuddling and non-sexual touching. And then finally, we decided to sleep together in the same bed. So we tried, I drew a little comic for the project, and it's also published in the little book there. As you can see, it didn't really go too well for me. I tried sleeping with earplugs, I tried a white noise machine, I even bought these headphones that are like in a headband, they're flat and they say they won't strangle you if you sleep with them on. But none of that worked. As you can see, it just got worse. And then finally, like, I was so exhausted, I was just like, I'm gonna sleep, I don't care. You can see what I go through. So, unfortunately, all of this failed. It did not go well. We had some times awake in the middle of the night, and this did lead to some really good sex, but that wasn't really the problem. It was the sleep, not the sex. So we remembered why we don't sleep together. We're much happier sleeping apart. And I have learned that we both probably have a REM sleep disorder, which is where you act out your dreams. And I don't dream that I'm laying on the beach. I dream that I'm running or jumping or kicking. And I have a recurring dream that this bee is trying to sting me. And like, I have woken up multiple times with my arm going like this, right into his chest. And that kind of thing is just not fair for your partner to be kicked or punched in their sleep. So we decided to go back to our separate beds. Oh, I forgot. I also remembered that this chronic fatigue and exhaustion causes migraines and fibromyalgia flares. And crazy sex causes a whole bunch of pain because I have endometriosis, and that's sort of why we were avoiding that. But you forget in the middle of the night when you're tired. It did open up lines of communication, and that has been really good for us. But why is this such a difficult topic? Why do we not talk about it? Why do you automatically assume that if you have a partner and you love them, you're gonna sleep in the same bed? And my experience has been, once you're married, everybody can ask about your sex life. And they ask, oh, when are you gonna have children? When are you gonna make a baby? It's sure fun practicing, right? But if I say, I don't want kids, I'm selfish. And if I tell them I have endometriosis, I don't have hope. And if I tell them, oh, hey, we don't sleep in the same bed, I'm weird. But I'm not the one asking about their sex life. Go figure. So I've had to learn to be very aware of who is asking me these questions, why they might be asking me these questions, and I've learned to answer carefully in a way that makes me comfortable, but also in a way that doesn't make you pity my relationship, because that's not what I want. So, in conclusion, poor sleep can have a domino effect on your life. Without restful sleep, your choices might be poorer than they would be normally. And you should turn into your partner, discuss with them what works for you as a couple, as an individual. And if culture says it's not normal, ignore that. It doesn't matter. You're not the whole culture. You are you. Experiment and do what works for you. Also, I want to say, since this paper was written, I've been a little bit more open about my relationship, and I've met some people, neighbors, friends, and even my own parents who don't sleep in the same bed. And actually, my parents for a while there were having a rough time, and they were really snippy with each other, and I think nobody was too sure if they were gonna stay together or not. But since they've stopped sleeping in the same room, they've been a lot nicer and a lot less snippy, and I'm sure they're okay now. And I've also seen a doctor about my sleep troubles, and I do not have sleep apnea, but that's all I know.
Hi everybody, my name is Jordan Killian, and I'm going to share a little bit about kind of my journey to having the first open and honest conversation about sex with my husband, and why it took me almost 4 years and until I was 25 years old. Shocking. So first I want to start out a little bit with telling you about some of my journey to getting to this point. And I want to talk a little bit about how I ended up in a human sexuality and erotic literature class, because that is, you know, if my comfort zone was maybe here, now my comfort zone is all the way over at the door. So I was signing up for classes, and I think we all kind of go through this struggle where it's, I can't find something that works with my schedule, I'm busy, I'm working, and how, you know, what do I find? How do I get into what I need to get this degree? And I saw that there was a human sexuality class with Fawn, and I was like, oh, Fawn changed my life in the first class that I took with her, so I'm in. And in my head, I'm thinking it was a psych of gender class as well. So I get into the classroom and I sit down for the first day and I realize this is not the class that I was expecting. This is not what I was expecting to get myself into. But this class and the time with Fawn and Stina, again, has changed my life forever. So if you ever have an opportunity to take a class with any of them, I suggest you take it. So a little bit about my background. I have always grown up in the church, and I have grown up in a very supportive family, but a very religious family. And I think that sometimes people can think about religious experiences, and for some people they're very bad and they're damaging. But for me, that wasn't the case. I grew up with a family that was more open and loving than I think many people even get to experience. I'm looking at my mom and she's making me cry. So, as far as my home life, it was fantastic. But we didn't really ever talk about sex, and we didn't really ever talk about sexuality. And because I was so involved in my church, I was the kid that was singing in the praise band. I was the kid that was a youth group leader. I was the kid that was spending every single day after class going to church to help my youth pastor set up. That was my life, and that was who I identified with. So that is where I started to develop my sexual schema. And I started to see sex and my sex life from the perspective of the church. And everything sexual in my mind, in my psyche, became very taboo. And the older I got, and the more I started to really lean into that belief system, the further removed I got from my peers and from my friend groups, because it's not very common to be the person that's not having sex. And it's not very common to be the person that's not going to push those boundaries. And so for me, I had a lot of trouble becoming comfortable with that. The kids in my youth group that were having sex weren't talking about it. And the people that I was dating, I wasn't letting them go past a boundary that I had set. So my sexual bubble just became smaller and smaller and smaller. So eventually it got to the point, you know, I grew up with words in my friend group. It was always joking, but those jokes are very damaging to your psyche and your schema. I was the goody-goody, the prude, the tease, and that was hard for me to take on. I think that there is kind of a dichotomous nature to either you're the whore or you're the prude, and either way, it's not good. So by the time I was out of high school, and it was probably around 2011, I started dating my husband, who is now my husband. And I started realizing that I was falling so far in love with him, and I loved everything about him. Up until this point, I was very complacent or nonchalant about the people that I had been with. I didn't want to be with them, so I wasn't going to be with them. And I started to feeling like I want to be with my husband. But the more that I kept feeling like that, the more I kept having this challenge to myself and my being, because it was innate within me that sex was off limits. It was not acceptable, and it was challenging all of those ideals that I was holding myself to. Throughout our dating process, we ended up having sex before marriage, and that to me was terrifying. My husband is the best person in the world. I love him and he loves me. But our first time was scary and it was painful, and it really had an effect on how I thought of myself. So because of that, I started feeling guilty, and I started it was like a monkey on my back that I was carrying around with me. And I had to have a conversation with him, and I said, I crossed a boundary that I wasn't ready to cross, and I understand if you want to be out of this relationship, but I love you, and I want to keep moving forward, but I'm giving you an out if you don't want to be here anymore, because I don't want to do this anymore until I'm married. My husband, being the guy that he is, I think he was a little taken aback by, why are you trying to end this? Which is kind of how I felt too. But he stuck with me. And he's like, it's okay. We'll go at your pace and that's okay. And I think that that's rare at 19 years old. So after that, 6 months later, we got engaged and I decided, okay, I am with this man. I love this man. I am going to, you know, we will have sex and it's going to be fine. So even though we started doing those things, I still felt this guilt. And part of me felt like maybe it was so painful and maybe I wasn't really able to get into it because it was God's punishment because I had done something outside of marriage. That came from never my family, but from something religious that I had held on to. And learning in this class that, oh, pain is normal, and oh, it's hard to have an orgasm for all women, it's not just me. And oh, it can sometimes feel like a chore because you're not having open conversations. It really changed who I am and who I thought about, what I thought about me. So this class and this opportunity, it really just opened me up. I was laughing with my husband last night and saying, you know, just getting in the classroom was way outside of my comfort zone. But being able to stand up here, you know, when your relatives, somebody that hasn't seen you in a long time, they come up to you and they say, oh, I haven't seen you since you were this big. Yeah, that's how I feel about my comfort zone. Oh, I haven't seen you since you were this big. You've grown so much. And I'm just much more confident about myself, who I am, who I want to be, and I'm really grateful that now I can be open. I think if you have an opportunity to take a human sexuality class, I guarantee you will learn something from it because it's just not something that we learn in schools, and it's obviously not something that we're learning in church either. And if you have an opportunity to take a class with Fawn or Stina, I promise you it will change your perspective. And if you're somebody that's sitting there and maybe was in the same position as me, or you feel uncomfortable, or you feel like you don't have a place to turn or a place to get knowledge, I'd be happy to share a little bit more of my experience with you as well.
Hi, you guys. I am Miriam Galvin.
And I'm Jacob Brackett. And this past fall semester of erotic literature and human sexuality, we read many texts throughout the semester about sexuality and found two of these texts that were really similar together.
All right. One of the ones that we read is Angela Carter, A Company of Wolves. Not only did she explore her sexuality, but she became empowered.
Angela Carter's rendition follows the classic tale of Red Riding Hood going to visit her grandmother, but takes a turn for the scandalous when the wolf tells her to strip off her clothes.
The other book we read was Lost Girls, and it follows a tale of Wendy from Peter Pan, Alice from Alice in Wonderland, and Dorothy from Wizard of Oz, exploring their sexuality. In chapter 19 of Lost Girls, the girls were on the train to a trip, and Dorothy began talking about her sexual experience with the lion, which is an actual boy, but he turns into a lion later on in the book. And we connected Angela Carter's story with that. And so we incorporated them both because they both explore bestiality and both our female empowerment.
We decided to do a text-to-text analysis of Red Riding Hood and it, as if she was in the Lost Girls. Mm-hmm.
Dorothy's story, she grew up on a farm, and she was verbally sexually harassed by the farm boy, but instead of being the victim, she took control, and he was a coward at that time, and then she took control and of the situation, and then she made him brave.
This woman empowerment is what inspired us to do the text-to-text analysis of the stories. And then we decided to call it kind of like the lost chapter of Lost Girls because we added it in. And we found a lot of parallels between the two, and that's why we decided to do the text-to-text analysis. The first one we found was the emotion and empowerment of both of the female characters.
Both women start off as vulnerable characters, but take their sexuality upon themselves to not be victimized. They take control of the situation and make them heard.
And in doing so, Dorothy makes the lion brave, and Little Red Riding Hood makes the wolf feel more accepted in his own character. And then we compared the women, or how both women kind of explored towards bestiality and like this idea of going for somebody who is a little bit more animalistic, because both men start as humans in the stories, but became more animalistic with sex. And we made the wolf feel like animal in his animal form in the story because we wanted to make him feel accepted in his natural form.
Mm-hmm. Oh, since we did the comic strip style, which you'll see in the book, we added a lot of visual elements. Some of them were, they're both begin as men and then transform into wolves or beasts throughout the text. And when they're having sex, the flames are burning low, and like as they climax, as the story climax, the flames begin to burn brighter and bigger.
We decided to add Red Riding Hood at the end of the story, leaving her red cloak behind, because this foreshadows the ending in Lost Girls, where Alice leaves behind her looking glass. Both the cloak and the looking glass are symbols that represent childhood innocence, and act as crutches for both of them to feel safe. And each character becomes empowered by leaving these behind and finding strength in themselves.
Mm-hmm. And something that we took away from this was to own your own sexuality. Do not be scared to, not everyone's out to hurt you. Sometimes they just want to play with you, but just be out there and own it if you have it. And if you don't have it, just figure it out. Take a human sexuality class. You got it.
Yep.
That's it. And then I'll leave Jacob to do his own.
So I had another presentation that for this from this class, and it was about discovering that I identify as a transgender. From a young age, I knew I didn't really identify with my assigned gender. I recall feeling confused and embarrassed whenever things came up that required me to identify with my assigned gender. When I was trying to out different religions, I was oftentimes felt like I was excluded because I knew that I liked guys, and I knew that I didn't feel like I assigned with my assigned gender, and so religion never felt friendly towards me. I felt like God made a mistake when he was making me, and so that just never really clicked. The religion really made me feel like my differences made me wrong, and it just was never a really welcoming environment. Coming out as gay, it was a really long and emotional process. I had to stop seeing myself and my sexuality as a negative. Overall, it went very well, and my parents accepted me, and the whole coming out process was pretty simple. The lack of knowledge of transgenders was really what made me think it was like I was just more of a flamboyant homosexual than anything else, and I never really questioned that. The first time I had actually ever heard of transgender was in high school, and it was a really limited amount of information, and so I had a really ugly view on it myself. I felt like they were just making a statement that it was a choice, and I didn't feel like I identified with those people. In the fall semester of this past year, I finally learned what transgender truly meant. And I learned that that the brain can develop as one gender while the body has the phenotypic traits to the opposite gender, and that it's totally natural, and that actually happens quite a bit. It was kind of like a light bulb moment for me because it was a lot of ambiguous emotions that I've been carrying for all of my life. and they just never really made sense. And then in the class, Fawn just came in and like turned on the light, and I saw everything clearly. I could finally label these ambiguous emotions and feel like I was a part of a community and didn't feel like I was broken anymore. I gained a sense of community and a way to own my own truth to the fullest. But with this new community, it came with new responsibilities, because we are oftentimes misunderstood with hateful misinterpretations, because people have fears about us, but they don't oftentimes ask us questions. And so those fears just reside and grow. We're still people, and we need to normalize and break stigmas to help the transgender community. Transgender is a label of other. History shows us how welcoming being a person of other is. So I was really nervous in realizing that I would have to come out again as transgender. Like, coming out as gay wasn't enough. Hate is inevitable, and public bathrooms still give me anxiety. I've been confronted more times than I can count. And we're really just fighting for a safe space in that sense. In the civil rights movement, it was never just about water fountains and seating on a bus. We were fighting to be recognized as human beings and not as second-class citizens. In class, we had a panel of sexual minorities, and I had the opportunity to ask if the people that were on this panel felt that identifying as their truest self isolated them more or helped them in the end. And what they said was that they explained the importance of knowing who you are regardless of what might happen, because living authentically outweighs the what ifs. Labels cannot define what we can achieve or who we can become. Coming out again, it was really terrifying, because my first time coming out was really unpleasant. It was full of self-loathing and full of bullies. My old fears of rejection and being misunderstood came up again, and I knew that I should feel more confident, because coming out as gay, my family and friends really accepted me, and like I knew that I had a sense of community, but this was a totally different thing. And so I really wasn't sure if they would accept me. Starting the process, I decided to start experimenting with more feminine clothes and makeup, just to try to like get them used to the idea of me identifying that way. My first actual experiment with this was at my mom's work dinner, where I dressed completely as I wanted to, and I was very easily passable as a female. And for the first part of the night, waiters were calling me by what I wanted to be identified as, and it was great. But then I had to go to the bathroom, and I was faced with the choice to go into a men's bathroom and be seen as a feminine, or go into the women's bathroom and risk not being feminine enough. I decided to go into the women's bathroom, but I found that there wasn't any achievement in it. It was more shame, because I stayed in the stall until I knew that they were all gone, and then I went back out. When I went back to the table, I had this fresh anxiety with me, and a waiter again called me a female, and my mom turned to me and she said, "Do you want me to correct them? It's really irritating me that they keep on getting your gender wrong." And that really hurt. I knew that it wasn't meant to hurt, but it still did. Words like irritation and they spawned from rejection, and it really made me wonder, is my mom going to accept me as I am? So I started to do some research, and I watched an episode of Dr. Phil, where they had a teen and her mom come on, and they were pretty much the worst case scenario. It was a mom who was embarrassed to go into public with her, refused to use her preferred pronouns, and told her that by 18 that she was going to be done with them, and her dad had already stopped talking to her incomplete. On that same episode, they had another teen and her mom come on, and they were the better case scenario, where they showed that having a good support system really does make a difference, and that it helped with her education that she was struggling with, and it really brought them closer together, and in letting go of those fears and just embracing the fact that she loved her child no matter what, it brought them together. being a fairly social and unquestionably queer teenager at the time, I have friends who love me and have accepted me as I am, as just something else. And a couple times recently, on different occasions, they asked me what my preferred pronouns were. And that really gave me a sense of, these people really care about me and are going to love me no matter what, and I can do this. So it gave me the inspiration to come out again. So I went to a helpful tips on how to come out as transgender website and found that the first step is coming out to yourself, because you can't own yourself you can't own your truth if you don't know who you are. The second tip is making connections, which lucky for me, I had this class full of people who were very open to sexuality, and I had teachers that were able to answer any of the questions that I had and break those stigmas that I once had about transgenders. Step three was scheduling the family meeting. I decided, they said that it was really important to try to do it in a friendly environment and to encourage questions. To not be discouraged by negative reactions, because they are afraid for you and not of you. They also recommended it's important to be patient with and help them see that you're still you, and that it is just changing, all that is changing is being a more genuine you. So coming out again, I scheduled my meeting with my family, and I opened the conversation up with, I learned something about myself in class the other day. This was a way of like making the conversation more welcoming, and made it welcome for them to ask questions and want to learn more. I told them that they didn't need to have a full understanding of something that I didn't fully understand myself. This is a whole different community, and it's a whole different part of my life that I'm just starting, and so it's okay to not understand it in full. Although the definition is new, the feeling has been there ever since I can remember. And I narrated for them what school had been like for me, being surrounded by girls who felt like girls and liked boys, and boys who felt like boys and liked girls, feeling broken and having a hard time making friends. It was hard to concentrate on school when you're constantly looking over your shoulder, wondering what people might be thinking about you. I struggled with depression for a while when I was coming out as gay, and talking with them openly about this struggle as well as that struggle really helped them understand what it was like. My mom told me, though, that throughout the past year, that she struggled to understand who I was and felt disconnected. But in coming out as transgender, it really helped her understand all those things that didn't make sense, and it really brought us together again. And she told me that she loved me no matter how I identified. And that was really all I really wanted to hear. And my mom's hesitation at the restaurant stemmed from fear, but not of me, but of the difficulties I'd face. Because as a transgender, I now face a higher risk of physical violence, and we are still fighting for basic human rights still. Giving myself this label empowers me to be who I am. I face and understand my childhood struggles, because I oftentimes blamed myself for being bullied, and I never felt beautiful growing up. Now that I can say that it wasn't my fault and that I am not broken, I can start to heal wounds I didn't realize still hurt. I don't have a conclusion exactly to what the future will bring. I have my friends and my family, and by owning who I am, I can help others that are struggling with their identity as well. By normalizing transgenders as humans with rights like everyone else, we can start making a change that helps us grow as a community. If we as a transgender community can live authentically and let our stories be heard, then we can eventually live as equals. And I don't think I would have been able to come out as this. I wouldn't have had this information had I not taken this class. This class, it gave me something that I'll never forget. Thank you.
It might be a mistake to be the MC for my own class's session, because I'm a little emotional right now. I'm so proud of you guys. Can we get another round of applause for these people while I collect myself? Oh my gosh. I'm so proud of you all. So proud, so privileged to have worked with you. We're going to open it up to question and answer now. I am going to start with a warning for all of you And then a comment, I think, for Tamara is where I will start. The warning is that, you know, you've been told by all these people, which is really generous of you to take this class. We've actually had faculty members take the class, and your peer was Leah Rogan-Roper, right? We get a thank you note from Leah Rogan-Roper's husband halfway through the semester. We really do. We get a thank you note. Roper writes us. He works in the wood shop. He's like, you guys, everybody should take this class. Everything's going really well at home, right? And then we get a sort of a hate letter from him because he was not ready to be a dad a second time, and the class was a little too effective. And the note said, you really should have covered birth control in more depth because they got pregnant and they have a second baby who's like my fault, which I just love it. I just love this baby. We did cover birth control. Maybe she just didn't take good notes that day. I cannot account for that. We covered it, right? Like, yeah, she should have known. She is the 1%. Anyway, and so the comment that I want to make to you, Tamara, and have you respond, if you don't mind. First of all, thank you for covering your topic. It really, you know, sex is connected to everything, and not least of all is sleep and our sleep habits. I sleep separately for my, now I just got legally married this weekend, so I've been with him for 10 years, and so we did everything kind of bass ackards, as my mom would say, and we finally got married after 10 years, but we've slept separately most of that time, and we find it to be very romantic, you know, so I have my bedroom, he's got his bedroom, and sometimes around 10:15, you'll hear a little knock at the door, and there might be some hot tea and some flowers. Can I visit? You know, it's like nice, but we get a lot of judgment for it, and we get a lot of what you said. There are people who hear about it and they give us this look like, sorry, your marriage is so screwed up. And it's like, you have no idea what's going on in my home. So can you speak to that judgment piece again, and maybe just that freedom from having to meet cultural expectations?
Well, so first of all, my degree focus is in anthropology, so I've always been interested in different cultures and what's normal in other cultures. So I never really carried that kind of stigma into my bedroom or into my relationship. But I have had people say, oh, it's so weird, it's so abnormal, like, you guys still have sex? Like, sex was never the problem. Getting sleep was the problem. And I choose sleep.
Okay, who's next? I will bring the mic to you.
It's not really a question so much as a comment for you, Tamara, but I think people lie about their sleep life as much as they lie about their sex life.
Who else? I will bring the mic to you. Comments and questions, please.
More of like a comment. So this is actually really great for me because I actually just kind of met Tamara or started to get to know Tamara this last year. And I didn't even know about the whole like sleeping separate thing with you. But my husband and I do sleep separate and have since I met him, because he snores horribly. But we're so happy right now. We're so, so happy. We even bought our first house this past year. But the thing is like, even like talking to my mom to this day, like, I don't feel like our marriage is like validated talking to her, because it's like, and it's almost like an embarrassment to be like, yeah, I sleep on the couch a lot. My couch is very comfortable, I will say. I sleep on the couch a lot, and it was like, so the past, this past Christmas, we went to visit, and I snuck out of our bedroom in the middle of the night at my parents' house to go sleep on the couch, and my dad ended up finding me. And it was like really weird to be embarrassed about that. It was like, you snore, come on, Dad, like, you know how awful this is. So I'm just so happy that like, there are so many people, it's not just me. So yeah, thank you, Tamara.
I actually don't know like how my parents made it 25 years sleeping in the same bed, because I know that my dad probably has that REM sleep disorder as well, because my mom complains that he's jumping or fishing or playing volleyball. Like, this is a real thing, and it's just I don't know how they do it. I don't know.
Okay, who next?
Thank you all for sharing your stories. They were all equally different and wonderful. My question is, because they were so personal, my question is what did you learn in the research process? All of the things that you learned so that you could take your very personal experience that you learned in the class and that you learned through reading or whatever your research was, and how could you take it to take the positive experience of what came out of this and move it into a topic that's not going to be personal? So what did you learn about the research process? Could be simplified.
So just, I think I can reframe this. I think I'm gonna translate. So, you know, you had really highly personal topics, which drove your research. Mm-hmm. And so then you had to go into research and do that. And so what did you learn from us, your teachers maybe, about research? We did cover that like a couple times, right? And what did you learn just by your own experience of doing the research that you could then take into other academic endeavors that maybe don't have as much to do with like a personal driven topic? Is this, did I translate correctly? Yes.
I think for me, I wasn't expecting to learn this about myself in the class. I went in thinking I was gonna learn about sexuality and all that, but I didn't think I was gonna learn something so personal about myself. And so in doing that, like I got a lot of information from my teachers about like that, and I got recommended to go to like a couple different like transgender like support groups and everything. And I think I would be outside of this, I'd be interested in going to more and learning more about it, because in the research I did look up and find more people in the community, and I didn't feel so alone in doing that. Like it felt like from a young age, it always felt like I was the only one that felt like this. And so learning that it wasn't as like sporadic, I guess, just learning that I have a community and that there are people that that can relate. I would like to be able to normalize it and be able to like be a support group for other people, you know?
Can I add a comment and follow-up question to what you just said? So to direct some of what you just said to the specific question, it sounds like you learned research is broader than just going to a database. Mm-hmm. That you actually learned research could be going into the community, meeting people, talking to people.
Yeah, and I think that like I didn't do that as much in my research for this project, but I would definitely want to talk to more people about it and see how they felt and see how similar and different our stories would be, I guess, and just like learning that about it and making friends that way would just be kind of interesting.
I think that although these topics were very personal to each of us, I think the research part that kind of came along with it, and I also did not go into the class expecting to learn what I learned. I wouldn't have thought anything was broken until I got in there and realized, wow, this is not a topic that is so taboo. And